Assalamu alaikum. Today we will continue the second part of section 5.2. We are in question number 6. He said, evaluate the following integrals by interpreting each in terms of areas. That means you need to graph the function in order to find this integral. Recall this. Integral from a to b f of x dx, generally it represents the net area. Do not forget this because it's very important. Integrate from minus 3 to 3 root 9 minus x squared. Well, first of all, we need to let y equal root 9 minus x squared. Square both sides, y squared equal 9 minus x squared. Arranging the terms will give you x squared plus y squared equal to 9. And this is what? This is a circle of radius 3 and center 0, 0. Let us draw it here. So this is the upper part of the circle. What is the reason for taking the upper part only? See here, we took y equal plus the root. I repeat, when you take y equal plus the root, that means the y values are positive. That means you need only the upper part of the circle. So this is our 3 and this is minus 3 and 3. And he said integrate from minus 3 to 3. These numbers, minus 3 and 3, are on the x-axis. See it here. Dx means integrate from minus 3 up to 3. So this is our minus 3 and this is our 3. So we have only this shaded region. I will call it A. Recall, if the function is non-negative, that means it is positive or 0, then the integral will represent what? The area. And what is the area here? It is just half circle. So this is half times by times the radius here is 3 square. And the answer is fairly simple, 9 by over 2. This question can be solved using another method, a section 7.3 using trigonometric substitution. Part B, which is the integral from 0 to 3 root 9 minus x squared. So it is the same question, but we need to integrate from 0 to 3. Again, it is the same story. We let y equal to this, and at the end of the day, we will get the same circle of radius 3. So this is the upper part of the circle, maybe. But be careful. He said here, integrate from 0 to 3. That means choose the values in the x-axis from 0 to 3. So we are interested in this region only. So if I call this region A, then this integral will be A, which is equal what? 1 over 4 by R squared, which is in this case 3 squared. So the answer will be 9 by over 4. So here we get half circle and here we get quarter of a circle. These questions are appearing in the exams a lot, so concentrate here. Part C, he said integrate from minus 3 to 0 root 9 minus x squared. So it is the same question again. So we need the upper part of the circle. Maybe it is here. But here we are interested in on the left part from minus 3 to 0. So this is our region of interest. So I will call it A. So this integral will be A, which is equal what? Again, it is the same story. It is 9 by over 4. Now I will give you the general case of this question. In general, if A greater than 0, then we have the following I. The integral from minus A to A root A squared minus X squared dx will be half by A squared. Again, please do not memorize things. Let us see it again. You just take Y equal the root. You square both sides, you will get y squared equal a squared minus x squared. Arrange the terms, you will get y squared plus x squared equal a squared, which is again, it is a circle of radius a and center 0, 0. So this is the upper part of the circle. Again, we said this because we need y equal plus the root. Good. We need to integrate from minus a to a. This is minus a, this is a. So this is what? This is half circle. So this is the half circle question. Now let us see part two. He said integral from 0 to a root a squared minus x squared dx will be what? Will be 1 over 4 by a squared. How can we see this? This is the quarter of a circle because we are interested on this interval from 0 to a. This is 0, this is a, so this is our region of interest. Clearly it is a quarter of a circle. Similar to part 2, we have part 3. If you have the integral from minus a to 0, it is the same story. This is minus a, this is 0, and this is the quarter of a circle. Again, do not memorize these formulas. This is just the general version of that question. The main reason for putting this formula is to understand carefully this question. See here, the integral from 0 to a, do you see this a? We need a square here, we need power 2 here. And also we need minus x square. So the coefficient of x square is what? Minus 1. So imagine you had this question in the exam. The integral from 0 to root 3, 12 minus 4x square. Can we apply the formula directly? No. Be careful. First of all, if you square this number, we get 3. Is it this number? No. And the coefficient here is not minus x square. There is extra 4 here. So what shall we do in this case? Just take it common factor. So you will get the integral from 0 to root 3. And this is root 4. I took it outside. And I am left with 3 minus x square dx. Now, you can take this root 4 outside the integral. It's a property we will learn it today. Now, without this root 4, clearly, if you take power 2 here, you will get 3. And this is minus x squared. So you can apply the formula directly if you wish, or you can draw. And this is very important. You need to understand in this course. So the answer directly will be what? This is 2. And this is a quarter of a circle. I will put it here. It will be 1 over 4 by... My radius is here, right? You can see it all the way. It is this number. So it will be root 3 all square. And this is computation. Check this. It will be 3 by over 2. Okay, now let us see part D. He said integrate this function from 0 to 3 x minus 1 dx. Well, let me give you a very nice note. If we give you this question, integrate a polynomial of degree 3 or less. This question can be done easily by definition. Why did I choose degree 3 or less? Because once you create your xi and delta x, etc., at the end of the day, you need summation of I cubed. Since it is degree 3, so for sure you will have summation of I3, summation I2, summation I, and the constant here. What about if I have degree 4 or more? You have two methods. Either you follow the idea in section 5.4 or you search in the internet for a formula for summation of I to the power 4. Great. Now let us go back to this question. So as I said, this question can be done directly using the definition, which is limit of summation f of xi delta x. Here is the definition, just to recall it quickly. Method number 3 is very, very easy, which is using section 5.4. The answer will be obtained in 10 seconds only. But today, let us solve it using the graph. So first of all, you need to take y equal x minus 1 here. And clearly, this is what? This is a linear function. Just give me two points and draw a line between them. So for example, let us start by 0. If you put 0 here, you will get 0 minus 1. That is minus 1. So this is a point with us in the graph. Let us choose 3. If you put 3 here, you will get 3 minus 1, that is 2. So 3, 2 will be with us here. Now join these points. For sure, you need to pass with 1. So where is my bounded region? For sure, you need to close it by a vertical line at 3 here and by a vertical line at 0, but it's very clear. Now, let me call this region A1 and let me call this region A2. It will be A1 and A2. Is it plus or minus? A1 should be minus because, as we said, it represents the net area. And A2 should be positive. So I will put plus here. This is a triangle and this is a triangle. It is very easy question. So let us do it quickly. So it will be minus half. The base here clearly is 1 and the height clearly is 1. So it will be 1 times 1 plus again half. What is the base starting from 1 up to 3? That is 2. And the height clearly can be seen here, it is 2. So this is minus half plus 2, which is equal 3 over 2. B part E. He said integrate this function from 0 to 10 absolute value of x minus 5. We will solve it using the graph method. And there is another method in section 5.4. Now, how to graph the absolute value function? You need to recall this from math 01 or from pre-calculus courses. It will be V-shape. This is y equal absolute value of x. But here we have absolute value of x minus 5. So what is the difference here? There is a shift 5 units to the right. So this will be the corner. And just to draw the graph carefully, let us substitute by 0 in the function. Substituting by 0 here will give you what? Absolute value of minus 5. And that is what? 5. So this point is with us in the graph. And let us substitute by the end point, which is 10. So 10 minus 5 will be what? Will be 5. So they will be at the same altitude. So let us draw the V shape together. And let us close by vertical line at 10. And let us close by vertical line at 0. So let us call this A1 and let us call this A2. The answer will be what? It will be A1 plus A2. Why? Because the function here above the x-axis and here it is above the x-axis also. Clearly this triangle is with the base 5 and height 5, and this is the same stuff here. So we will have half times 5 times 5 plus again half 5 times 5. This is 25 over 2. 25 over 2. Add them together. This is very easy. This is 25. Good. Here we have a question. He said we must redefine the absolute value, right? In fact, your method will be given in section 5.4. So let us wait for that section. Another question. He said, can we solve it without drawing? Yes, as I said, this is method number 2. It will be learned in section 5.4. Now, if you see the recording, please try the other questions. We solved up to part E. Please solve the others up to part J. Now, let us go to the midpoint rule. The midpoint rule. He said, the integral from a to b f of x dx is approximately equal summation f of x I bar delta x. Let us substitute by 1. You will get what? F of x 1 bar times delta x for sure. We took it as a common factor at the end. Substitute by 2, you will get f of x 2 bar. And you need to end with n, so this is f of x n bar. Where delta x equal b minus a over n as we defined before. And what is the definition of xi bar? Let us read it. It is half xi minus 1 plus xi. That means it is the midpoint of this interval. Just see it. You just add them and you divide by 2. And also there is a definition for xi bar. It's good to know it. It is a plus I minus half delta x. Let us explain this here. Again, you remember the number line. This is the interval AB. This is x0, this is x1, x2, etc. up to xn. And here, at the middle, for sure, we will have xi minus 1 and xi. Let us recall, the distance from here to here is called delta x. And the distance from here to here, it is delta x. This is uniform delta x. Now, what is the midpoint between x0 and x1? We will take it and we will call it x1 bar. Similarly here, the midpoint in the next interval, we will take it and we call it x2 bar. Similarly here, etc. If we get to this interval, we will call it xi bar. And here it will be xn bar. This is just to understand it. Question number 7 is about the midpoint rule. He said, use the midpoint rule with n equal to 3 to approximate the integral from 1 to 7, 1 over x dx. Well, first of all, here a equal to 1, which is our point here. And b equal to 7, which is the point at the top here. And also, the function f of x is equal to what? It is given here inside the integral, which is 1 over x. Now, you remember delta x by definition, b minus a over n. That is 7 minus 1 over n. He gave us 3. sub-intervals. So if you evaluate this, you will get 2. Start by the beginning here, which is 1. Add delta x to it, you will get 3. Add it, you will get 5. Add it, you will get 7. Just to double check. He said 3 sub-intervals. Let's check. This is 1, this is 2, this is 3. So what is the midpoint here? Just add 1 plus 3 divided by 2. For sure, you will get 2. Do it here. 3 plus 5 over 2. You will get 4. And clearly here, you will get what? You will get 6. Now, these are our sample points. So, the integral from 1 to 7, 1 over x dx, approximately equal to m3. M denotes midpoint, 3 denotes the number of subintervals, which is equal to f of the first, which is 2, plus f of 4, plus f of the last one, which is 6. And do not forget to multiply by delta x. This is very simple computation. The function is 1 over x. You can see it here. So we have 1 over 2, 1 over 4, plus 1 over 6. And you need to multiply by 2. If you evaluate this, you will get for sure 11 over 6. Here I have a quick note. If he said use 3 subintervals, use 3 rectangles, etc., make sure you have 3 sample points here. That means you have f of the first plus f of the second plus f of the third one. Either you take right endpoint or left, or you take mid. Make sure you have 3 of them or 4 of them. It depends on the number of rectangles which is in here. Now I will give you 1 minute to solve the following exercise, and if you see the recording, please stop the video and take 1 minute to solve this question. Okay, time is up. Just this very quick note. Make sure you get this interval. You need to take f at 1 plus f of 3 plus f at 5. Then you need to multiply by delta x, which happens here to be 2. So this is the answer. Make sure you will get 25 over 6. Now, the properties of the definite integral. If f and g are continuous functions and c is a constant, then we have the following properties. Property number 1. It says the integral from a to b f of x dx is equal minus the integral from b to a f of x dx. That means if you need to switch a and b, you can switch them, but you need to multiply by a minus sign. Let us recall the definition of the integral. The integral from a to b is equal limit of summation f of x I delta x. So if you evaluate this integral or this integral, you need to evaluate delta x first. So delta x in this left integral will be what? It will be b minus a over n. But for the other one, it will be a minus b, because we subtract this way, top minus bottom. Then you divide by n. So what is the difference between this delta x and this delta x? You need to just multiply by a minus sign. Clear? Now, let us see the next property, which is the integral from a to a f of x dx is equal to 0. What is the reason behind this? Well, you just compute delta x again. Let me put it in this rectangle. Delta x will be what? A minus a, right? It will be a minus a over n. So it will be 0. So if you apply things in this definition, this will be 0. The summation of 0 is 0. The limit of 0 is 0. So everything will be 0. Another way to see it, let us consider this special case where y equal f of x greater than or equal to 0. The integral will represent the area directly. So what is the area from a to a? It will be 0. There is no area. There is no net area, in fact. Part 3. He said the integral from a to b c dx equals c times b minus a. Remember, c is a constant. So if you have a constant, pull it outside, then multiply by what? B minus a, which is the length of the interval. Let us see the proof together. The integral from a to b c dx using the definition limit of summation f of x I delta x. So let us calculate this together. F of x I will be what? Will be c, because the function is constant. Delta x will be b minus a over n. This is I equal to 1 up to n. Now let us simplify. This is the limit. Now, is there any I here? No. C has nothing to do with I, and similarly this fraction here. So we can take it outside the summation. So I will write c b minus a over n. So I am left with summation of 1. What is summation of 1? This is a property we said, you just multiply this number by this n. So this will give you n. And here you have cb minus a over n. And the limit of a constant is a constant at the end of the day, right? Because n will be cancelled with n. Here's the answer, cb minus a. This is the proof. Also, let me give you a figure here. It will be nice so that you do not forget the idea behind this. Let us see a special case here. Assume y equal c greater than 0. Again, I repeat, this is not a proof, but this will help you to visualize things. If y equal to c constant, which is greater than or equal to 0, this is y equal to c is a horizontal line like this, and this is a and this is b. So the integral will be what? From a to b, c dx. It will be equal directly to the area because it is positive. And what is the area here? See it here. It is a rectangle. The height is c, and the width is what? B minus a. So it is c times b minus a. This is another way to see this property. It is good to know the idea behind it. Now let us see property number 4. He said the integral from a to b f of x plus or minus g of x dx is equal the integral of f plus or minus the integral of g over the interval from a to b. That means you can distribute the integral over the sum over the subtract. The main reason behind this is the definition. Remember, the integral of f of x is what? Is the limit of summation. But the summation can be distributed over the sum or subtraction, right? And the limit also, provided that these things are well defined. So the summation can be distributed over the addition or subtraction, and the limit can be done also. So at the end of the day, the integral will be distributed over the sum and the subtraction. Clear? Also, we have property number 5. The integral from a to b c f of x is equal c the integral of f. That means you can pull this constant outside the integral. What is the reason behind it again? It is the same story. If you have a constant multiple of the function f, you can put it outside the summation. And if you have constant inside the limit, you can pull it outside, provided these things are well defined and exist. So the integral can have this property. Also, we have another nice property, and this is the last one. The integral from a to c plus the integral from c to b is equal the integral from a to b. Just to see it carefully, this is your c and this is your c, right? So you can connect them this way. So the integral will be from where to where? From a to what? From a to b directly. Just to understand this idea, I will give you a special case. See here, we consider the special case f of x greater than or equal to 0, where c between a and b. Now, if I say the integral from a to c, this will be the blue region, or sorry, the integral from a to c will be the red region here. And I need to add to it the integral from c to b, that is what? The blue region. So if you add the red plus the blue, what do you get? Clearly you will get what? The total area here. So that is the integral from a to b. Again, I repeat myself, this is not a proof, this is just a special case, just to see things here. And let me say something. In general, it is not necessary to have c between a and b. C can be outside the interval. Let me give you an example here. Imagine you have the integral from 0 to minus 3 plus the integral from minus 3 to 7. Minus 3 is not inside the interval from 0 to 7. In fact, it is outside. In fact, here we can join them. So this is a general property. So at the end of the day, you will get the integral from 0 to 7. Now we will see exercises to illustrate the idea behind this. If you have any question, please ask me now. Here we have a warning, so let us be careful. He said the integral from a to b f of x g of x is not equal to the integral of f times the integral of g. That means you cannot distribute the integral over the product of functions. Similarly, you cannot do it over the quotient. That means the integral of f over g is not equal the integral of f over the integral of g. This is a common mistake. So let us recall this. The integral can be distributed over the addition or the subtraction or constant multiple, but cannot be distributed over the product or over the quotient. This is very common mistake. Just to give you an example, later on you will understand what I mean here. Usually, if we give the students this question, the integral of x sine x dx, they usually say, this is easy, this is the integral of x dx times the integral of sine x dx. This is a disaster. Let us be careful. This is not correct. Now we will go to question number 8, which is about properties of the definite integrals. First, he said, find the integral from 1 to 1 x squared cosine x dx. What do you think? The answer will be directly 0, because this is a continuous function. If you integrate from a to itself, the integral will be 0. This is property number 2. You can't check it. Now we go to part B. He said, find the integral from 0 to 5, 2 plus this nice root. Well, we said this is a property. We can distribute over the addition. So we have 2 dx plus the integral from 0 to 5, root 25 minus x squared dx. Now evaluate this alone, and give me the answer. Well, this is very easy. Can you tell me the answer in the chat? This is 2 times, thank you very much. This is 2 times 5 minus 0. This is a property, 2 times b minus a. Plus, what about this? The integral from 0 to 5, 25 minus x squared dx. This is a familiar question. This is the question of a quarter of a circle, right? This is 5, this is 25, and the coefficient of x squared is minus. So clearly, this is the graph. You just write y equal to this root, and at the end of the day, for sure, you will get y squared plus x squared equal 25. And we need this part only. So it is a quarter of a circle. That is 1 over 4 by, and what is my radius? You can see it here, it is 5. So this is 5 squared. So if you simplify things, you will get 10 plus 25 by over 4. Good. Now let us see part C. He said, if the integral from 0 to 10 for the function f is equal to 17. The integral from 0 to 8 is equal to 12 for the same function. The question is to find the integral from 8 to 10. Well, in this question, I prefer to do it this way. I draw a number line here. Then I will put all the numbers. This is 0. This is 8. For sure, you need to order them. And this is 10. See here. He said the integral from 0 to 10 is 17. And the integral from 0 to 8, which is this region, is 12. And he said, what is the integral from 8 to 10? That means this is our unknown. I think this is very clear to us. The whole is 17 and part of it is 12. So the rest will be what? It will be 17 minus 12, that is 5. The integral from 0 to 8 plus the integral from 8 to 10 is equal to what? You remember that property? This is 8, we can connect this way. So the integral will be from 0 to 10 directly. Again, do not forget to write f of x dx all the way here. And as we said, from 0 to 10, this is 12. And this is 17. So this is our unknown. Simple. I will directly write the integral from 8 to 10, f of x dx is equal to 5. Which is 17 minus 12. Great. Now let us go to part D. He said, if the integral from 0 to 1 for the function f is 7, and the integral from 0 to 1 g of x is 4, we need to find the integral from 0 to 1 to f minus g. Well, this is very straightforward. I wrote it here. Just use the properties only. So this will be the integral from 0 to 1 2 times f of x, minus the integral from 0 to 1 g of x. You see here, this is constant. From the properties, I can take it outside. So everything is easy. These two times, the integral from 0 to 1 for the function f is 7 minus the integral of g is given to be 4. This is 14 minus 4, that is 10. Now, let us go to the last part, which is comparison properties of the integral. We had properties of the integrals. Now, we have more properties. They are called comparison properties of the integral. The first, if f greater than or equal to 0 on this interval from a to b, then the integral of f will be greater than or equal to 0. How can we see this? We can see easily this by the definition. Remember, if f of x greater than or equal to 0, then the integral from a to b f of x dx will represent the area under the curve because the function is non-negative. And we know this, the area cannot be negative. So the integral is non-negative. So this is property number one. Clear? Now let us see property number two. It says, if f greater than or equal to g on this interval, then the integral of f greater than or equal the integral of g. That means you can integrate both sides. How can we see this? The proof is given here. Assume f of x greater than g of x on this interval ab. This is given, you can see it in the f statement. Let me take g on the other side. This will be f of x minus g of x greater than or equal to 0. Now let us use property number one. It says if you have a function which is non-negative, then the integral will be also non-negative. That means I can simply integrate f of x minus g of x dx, and this will be non-negative for sure from a to b. Now you just use the properties of the integrals. Integral of f minus the integral of g, and this is greater than or equal to 0. For sure, this is dx, and this is dx from a to b. And the last point is to move g of x on the other side, so you will get g dx from a to b, and here we have a to b f of x dx. And clearly, we can see the property. If f greater than g, then the integral of f greater than or equal to g also. This is called property number two. Now, finish with property number three. It says if m less than f less than capital M on this interval, then the integral of f is bounded between these numbers. See here, small m is appearing here, and capital M is appearing here, but we multiply by b minus a. What is the reason behind this multiplication? I will give you the proof. Let m less than f of x less than m. These could be the minimum and the maximum for the function on the closed interval. Simply, just use property number one and two. Integrate everything. You will get the integral of m less than or equal the integral of f of x dx less than the integral of capital M. For sure, do not forget a b. I will ask you in the chat, answer now please. What is this integral? And what is this integral? You have 10 seconds only. Okay, great. This is a constant. The integral of constant is what? The constant times b minus a. So this is b minus a, and this is m, small m, b minus a. And let us write the middle integral as it is. So this is the proof. If m less than f less than capital M, then the integral will be bounded between these numbers.
Here we have question number 9. It says estimate this integral from minus 1 to 2 e to the power x squared dx using the comparison properties. Well, this question is based on this property number 3. If m less than f less than capital M, then the integral of f is bounded between these two numbers. In fact, our job here is to find small m and capital M, plug them here, and that's it. Well, as I said, we need to find the absolute maximum capital M and the absolute minimum small m for f of x, which is equal e to the power x squared, which is here, on the interval minus 1 to 2, which is given here. In fact, see section 4.1 to remember the method which is called the closed interval method. He said to find the absolute maximum and minimum values of a continuous function f on a closed interval AB. Step number one, find the values of f at the critical numbers of f in the open interval AB. Step two, find the values of f at the endpoints of the interval. Step number three, the largest of the values from step number one and two is your absolute maximum, and the smallest of these values is the absolute minimum value. Let us do them here. As I said, step number one, find the critical numbers of f on the open interval minus 1, 2. We will start by finding the derivative of this function. This is simple. By the chain rule, we have 2x, the derivative of the exponent, times e to the power x squared. Well, we have two situations here to find the critical number. Either the derivative equal to 0, and if this is the case, we need to solve 2x e to the power x squared equal to 0. And this is very clear that x equal to 0, and note e to the power x squared cannot be 0. In fact, it is greater than 0. Also, situation number 2, f prime of x d and e, this is impossible. Since f prime always exists, this is a differentiable function. Step number two, we need to use the table. We will put the critical number, which is 0, and we will put the endpoints, which are minus 1 and 2. Now we calculate f of minus 1 equal e to the power 1, that is e. And also we calculate f of 0, which happens to be 1, and we calculate f of 2, which happens to be e to the power 4. Now, what is the maximum among these numbers? It is very clear that the maximum is e to the power 4. Let me use another color here. Yes, this is the maximum, capital M, and the minimum is 1. Remember, e is approximately 2.718. So, I will say the function e to the power x squared between its minimum and its maximum, which is e to the power 4. Now integrate everything. For sure on the interval minus 1, 2. And as we said, this is a constant, so you just multiply by b minus a. Here, b minus a is 3, so you just multiply 3 by 1, that is 3. And you will copy this. And this will be 3 e to the power 4. In fact, we estimate this integral by the following two bounds. A final note here, this integral, once we finish the course, we cannot find this integral exactly. In fact, this integral has no antiderivative, so it is good to know how to approximate it. If you need an example to try, take this part number B and stop the video. Here is the final answer between 0 and 2 over E. And let us see more questions on properties of the definite integral. Please solve E, F, G, and H. Thank you very much.